trapped exploring the honeypot. My name's April.
Richard.
Trevor.
And Michael.
So first we'll go over a little introduction about what we are about, how we got where we are, our story, and then we will talk a little about the value and significance of honeypots, and that also includes our literature review. And then we will talk a little bit about our network topology and our defense strategy, move into how we were attacked and how we would gain access to some of the machines, but not all of them. And then we'll move on to the attack strategy we use for other teams, and then conclude by going over what we said already. So in Dr. Ho's class, we were given a few machines to protect. And so everyone on the team had four machines to protect, and we had a few shared machines. We had Palo Alto, we had PFSense, we had Security Onion, and all of these were combined to create our own network, which we had to protect using the Palo Alto machines and using those other tools that we decided to use for the project. And so we did a little bit of research, and we decided to try to find out what we could do for our project, and we kind of stumbled upon honeypots. We used them in the past when we were in Dr. Ho's class. We used this software called Honeybot, and we actually ended up using that for this project too, along with a few other type of software systems. And so we decided that was something we wanted to do, and go for a passive type of attack and defense strategy, just for the beginning of the project. And then we finally moved on to a little bit more of an offensive attack strategy when we weren't able to get the same results we wanted to get with our actual honeypots as a latent defense. So here are the basics. Businesses have information, and usually they don't like to secure it until it's too late. Something happens, a leak happens, like with the Target hack, where 40 million credit and debit card users were put into the fire, basically. This information was collected by almost like a key logging system, and by the time Target knew what was happening, it was too late, and all the information was leaked. So that happened back in 2013, and now they have new security measures in place to try to prevent that, but like I said, it's already too late. We already lost 40,000 or 40 million credit card and debit card numbers to the system. So the attackers want access to that information. They obviously want access to that credit card information and debit card information so they could sell it somewhere else or, you know, buy a yacht. Maybe that's something they want to do. And companies can take matters into their own hands with honeypots. Honeypots, like I said, are a topic of choice, and honeypots can actually help you protect your system while also having a latent type of security measure in place so that you can kind of see what's going on in your machine without having to constantly monitor it. You can kind of check in on it and kind of see if anyone's been on there and should be on there and is poking around.
So do I start the literature review? We did a lot of research on honeypots, and we really, throughout the research, we kind of had a better understanding of the value of honeypots. So honeypots can slow down intruders' progress. They can decrease the rate of false positives. They can also capture malware for analysis, and we can better understand our intruders and what they're trying to do and how they're doing it by the use of honeypots. Well, why people use honeypots? They either use it for reduction for organizations to protect and detect intruders going into organizations, and also research. Other than our example of our team researching honeypots, I found a research in India that was conducted in 2017 where they tried to strengthen honeypots by using the IP spoofing method. The IP spoofing detection method actually strengthened the honeypot by being able to detect if it was a user actually going in or someone actually, an intruder, trying to get into the system.
Okay, so here's our network topology. We have Dr. Ho's PFSense firewall at the top. That's our SecNet virtual environment, where we have host all of our virtual machines. Through there, we have our Komodo and Security Onion machines connected, one of which is running Zubuntu, and the other is running Windows. Our Security Onion was used to capture traffic from the entire network. We monitored a whole bunch of different IP address ranges. And through there, we have our two Palo Alto firewalls, and those were used to create a VPN tunnel between the two and secure all of our traffic within our internal network, where we connected our Ubuntu, Kali Linux machines, Apache Web Servers, and 7 base machines. Their IP addresses are listed on the 192.168.72 range, as was mentioned before. And then, next slide please. Once we changed it, once we put it behind the firewall acted as a DHCP server and assigned its own addresses to the machines, where it went into the 16.350 through 60 range and .4.50 through 65 range in order to accommodate all of our machines at the same time, because our lease was set to about 2 days. Our assets were 5 Apache, Kali, Linux, Windows, and Ubuntu machines. We had the 1 Komodo and 1 Security Onion, 2 Palo Alto firewalls. When we were attacked, we had 3 of our Windows machines compromised, and we were able to recover 2, so only the 5th machine that none of our team was using was not able to be recovered.
We tried to jump on the train as fast as possible when it came to protecting our systems, but unfortunately we were a little bit late because one of the other teams was able to log onto our machines, like they had been open all the time. And so we tried to put in some of these measures afterward. So some of them were put on some machines and not others, just because we had lost access to those other ones. But the main idea for our strategy was to put in firewalls and create the VPN tunnel. And then we changed all of our passwords on all the machines so that they weren't the uniform password that was kept for all the machines for the entire class. And then we put honeypots and keyloggers on each of the machines that we could. So that ended up being all the machines except for the ones that were compromised. We also did any adapter changes just in case any of our computers were going through to the internet through our SecNet switch, which was different than the one that we needed to go actually through our firewalls. So that ended up being a vulnerable point too, but we found that we were able to switch that too. We also decided to shut down our machines when we weren't using them, and to go along with that, we put on automatic lockout so that if we were not touching our machines for more than 10 minutes, they would shut down on their own so that no one could, like I said before, sit down and just jump into the machine like it was theirs the entire time.
So for our firewall configuration for the Palo Alto, we had too many services that were left available. These are outbound services, however, we didn't want to take any chances and let an intruder get in through any of these services. So we had things like FTP enabled, and we realized that really wasn't necessary because we're not using FTP. We eventually even disabled HTTP and only allowed secure traffic through, as well as SSL, but not TLS because of its security vulnerabilities. Excuse me. We left ping enabled for our attacks that we'll discuss later, as well as troubleshooting. It makes it a lot easier to be able to ping outside sources that's if we have some issues. We kept DNS and all those essential services connected. However, disabling HTTP proved to be a little unrealistic because there are still some sites that are not secure.
So while we focused on the honeypot for our project, we also used it in conjunction with keyloggers. So keyloggers, in a very general sense, take whatever you're typing in the machine and they keep it. So that if you were to install something on your machine, you could type in, my username is this and my password is this, and it would print it out for you later. So you could go check it. And you can use this obviously for malicious reasons. You can put this, like I said, with a target. This was to keep all the information for the credit cards. So we put both of those on the machines that we could. So the top picture right here is one of my keyloggers. So I put it on the Komodo machine, and I tried to watch it to see if anyone was getting in and doing anything. So all of the different processes on there and processes are showing that that's all me, and I can verify that each one of them was me. But if something were to pop up that I didn't like, I could go investigate it and see if someone was on my machine. And then the bottom picture here is from a honeypot. And unfortunately, Honeybot, the one that we used, was having a little bit of a glitch. And I found it online that they were having this problem. So I wasn't able to pick up some of the traffic. But as with the free version, you might kind of expect problems like that to happen. But with the paid version, you understand that that if you're watching this and you start seeing something pop up that say someone tried to nmap everything on your network, then you can see it pop up that they had like pushed all these ports, and you can say, wow, something's gone with my machine, you know, you need to change it. So the use of the keyloggers is for, like I said, maintenance and vigilance, because you want to kind of see what's going on and see if anything's being changed, and just kind of like keep an eye out for your machine. While the honeypot, we used Honeybot, but we used it in conjunction with Valhalla. Valhalla was a Portuguese program that was hidden. There were no icons displayed for it. You had to know exactly where it was to open it. You had to know the exact keys to open it. So Honeybot, you could just pull up. It was right there on your screen. You knew that it was running, but Valhalla was running in the background. We used Honeybot in one of our last classes with Dr. Ho. So if we used that, we knew that other teams were going to know that we were probably using that because they knew we were working with Honeybots. So if they go in and try to disable that, we had this hidden one checking the movements of them so that if they were in there and they disabled it, we would know that they were still in there.
We were attacked by a team of invisible fishes. It was a painful attack on the weekend of the 30th through the April 1st. In that process, our Windows machine BO3, BO4, and BO5 were compromised. Jaffe and I tried to fix our issues and get our admin access back. First, we tried to just to get our systems back and running, reset our virtual machines, and I tried to do become the task manager from this bat file right here, kill task manager, which only gave me temporary admin access. And then the other fixes were the get user command, which I'll let Jaffe talk about that right now.
So going off what you said, to get all our machines back, we used the net user command, and you can play the video that kind of walks through everything that we did to get all of our accounts back and do a little bit more with that. But keyloggers on our machines caught what they changed the password to of our other administrative accounts, and from there we were able to go into those accounts, and using the net user command, we could change back our accounts, regain admin access, and then change our passwords. And we took that a little bit further and used net user to gain access to her account, which was SMHO, that's on every machine. So this video walks us through how we took over our accounts. The keylogger in the bottom caught what Team C, who had taken over our machines, changed our passwords to. And from there, we were able to go onto another admin account, and via the command prompt with net user, we were able to change the passwords back, regain administrative access, and change all the passwords on there. And the video goes through everything here and goes through net user. And by typing net user, the account name, and then whatever you want the password to be, if you're an administrator, it'll automatically change it. And that works for that account, it works for SMHO. And after doing that, we realized that we could reverse this into a different attack method to gain access to the other machines. And that's what we did, is we downloaded Mimikatz, which is an open source tool that pulls information from the memory. And by doing that, it keeps the stored passwords that are in the registry and pulls them up into the hash, which is displayed below, and all the dumped hashes of every user is displayed. So we took that hash and ran it through a decoder to get the actual password, which is on the next slide. So the password to every SMHO account was @NG1M33R. So after we did that, we were able to go onto everyone else's machines and go into SMHO and, with the net user command, take over every account on there. So we took over AO3, AO4, AO5, and CO5 that still had SMHO on there. And after we removed admin access from the other accounts, we just changed the passwords again and were able to keep those accounts.
So very quickly, we ran a ping flood and traced the said ping flood. Unfortunately, we had the ping outbound firewall rules blocked at the time, so security onion was not able to pick it up, and ultimately the packets were just discarded. However, it was just a simple Windows command that iterated through a large number of ping commands to a target machine over in another team's environment. Here's a visualization of our compromised assets and the ones that we were able to keep and or recover. You see only one was lost.
To conclude, include, we talked about, we had a discussion on the value and why we use honeypots in today's world. We also talked about our firewall vulnerabilities and how we fix those using more access controls, such as the automatic lock after 10 minutes. We talked about our attacks and our defensive maneuvers that we use to get our admin access back, and then we use our defensive strategy to gain other people's machines. And then our access count is actually wrong right here, especially since we got AO3, AO4, and AO5 and CO5. So the only Windows machine is still compromised is BO5, so it's around 29 assets to be recorded.
Okay, great job.
So if you had your home system and you want to play around with honeypots, would you recommend using the free version of honeypots or go for the paid version? Would it be worth it?
I would definitely
say
go for paid.
Do you know how much
they cost? I do not know how much it costs. But there are a lot of different types of honeypots you can use. It's just we used honeypot because it was a free one that we used before.
Okay, so the perks and the paid one would outweigh the price. You're saying. Right, thank you.
I think so.
Steven?
Did y'all draft to use Mimikatz to grab the other hashes for the other passwords and try to crack those?
Yep, and that's it would work with any account on the machine. So if there's 50 accounts, you could just run all 50 hashes through the coder, and it breaks it with a hash table, and it will display the password just as it did with that one.
So Dr. Ho, where's the extra coder?
I'll think about it.
So you used SMHO to get access to the machines after you found out her password. Why didn't you do it on like all of them if we all have that?
It was a last minute thing.
Oh, so you just
yeah. Finally got it yesterday. Two of Team C's machines were broken.
Oh,
and
yeah.
We took over every one of A's machines, except we found out they needed one of them for the presentation. So we had to give that back.
Also,
so technically did take every single machine.
You guys should have told me. I would have fixed your machines.
And then just take it.
Yeah, and then just taking it.
Devices.
Just out of curiosity, what kind of hash is it?
It was just a regular NTML hash. It's a Windows operating system hash.
Okay.
Yeah,
Carla, so I thought with the hash that you weren't able to reverse.
Yeah, it said irreversible. I just saw that just today.
Yeah.
That's what I'm wondering too. I thought it generated two different hashes and it compared the two, and that's the whole point. Do you have an answer to that? So normally you generate a hash over here and then you generate a hash over here and you compare them to make sure they're the same. However, you said that you cracked the password using the hash.
Yep, so just with the hash, you can use it. And I uploaded it on the online dictionary attack website, and it just ran through a bunch of, I guess, codes to run it through. But I know you can use different programs like using class, Jack the Ripper and NCrack could also do it. So pretty much any hash that's on there, you could get into any Windows user.
Connor?
How are you able to demote another admin from another admin account? Does her admin account have better credentials?
Either her account's super admin or just Windows 7 lets you, because it easily let us change in just regular settings and put it to standard user.
Yeah, all admins are actually created equal on Windows. They're able to mess with each other in equal capacities.
Actually, once we got our admin access back from our own computers, didn't you demote Professor Ho?
Mm-hmm. And then you can change your own standard user. You can once you're an admin, you can change anything on there.
Right. Connor.
When did you take over CFI?
When did we take over CFI?
Mm-hmm. Yesterday.
Yeah.
We just went through and took over everyone that still had
even
SMHO.
Though we weren't supposed to.
When did you take over CO2 Apache and Kali?
You can take over, because she has her account on everyone. You can take Ubuntu, Kali, Apache. Just didn't know if you guys would need them.